Since 1991, ProTaper has led the way in premium control components and prides themselves on providing an exciting, innovative, and complete product line to fulfill the needs of professional racers and weekend riders alike. Through revolutionary ideas like the oversized 1 1/8-inch handlebar and the micro handlebar kit, the only control system purpose-built for youth riders, ProTaper continues to push the limits and transform how we experience riding our motorcycles. Visit ProTaper.com for more. Everyone, welcome to the Kickstart Podcast presented by ProTaper. It is the Monday after the Indianapolis Supercross. Chase Curtis are here in SML headquarters. Anton, remote. A-Ray at O'Neill headquarters. And, you know, the Indianapolis Supercross brings back a lot of, like, memories for me, emotions and stuff. And, like, being an Indy in general, because there used to be a gigantic motorcycle trade show there. At the same venue, and that was where I first met Anton. I was there for Transworld Motocross, and Anton comes running up to me with a folder in his arms, kind of like the way Marsha Brady held her notebook and Brady Bunch, and he's like, check out these photos I took of my brother, I want to work for you someday. And that's how we met.
Perfect.
Yeah. Heck yeah, and then I take my guy on track walk this weekend, and I'm trying not to cry the whole time because, like, I know how it all came together. So thank you, Swap. Like, thanks everybody. Like, no, dude. Even during opening ceremonies, I was like, "Wow, man, this is surreal." That, like, my wife and baby are up in the press box that I was like making all this like kind of come together in, and I like could feel the knot in my throat right there. And then this kid comes running over and he like hits me on the shoulder. He's like, you're Anton. So I had to not cry in front of this other kid.
Yeah, man.
Because I was like, holy shit, this is coming together. And then we take a picture together. So yeah, Indy Supercross is sick. Yeah. I love that.
Dude, it looked like it was sold out on TV.
That one goes off. That one goes off so well because like Ohio, Michigan, Kentucky, Tennessee, like it's within a 6-hour drive of so many places. And then it's a good stadium. You know, it is a really, really good stadium, like 64,000 people this weekend, another record-setting attendance this year. Like every place we've gone since, I think, Arizona to now has been like record-setting, you know, numbers. So turnout's been huge. And like, why wouldn't it be? The racing's great, you know?
Yeah. And another thing, too, the thing about Indy, it always falls on St. Patrick's Day. And it's Indy's, the town itself, like the whole downtown vibe, like with the St. Patrick's Day and everything. Nightlife afterwards, a lot of the guys like to, you know, sometimes go out after the races, you know, at Indy, just because it's like super fun there too. So yeah, that's awesome.
Yeah, it's definitely a lot of people that wear like high-vis fluorescent clothing for work all week that then go drink as much Miller Lite as they can, and like it's tight. Like, I mean, that's what it is, and it's from all over. And like that pit party, now that they've made a fan fest for that race, because years ago they didn't because the weather was so bad. It's one of the more popular ones because all these people want to see these guys. Like, it's the most core fan, I think, of like the East Coast little Rust Belt area. Yeah.
So, Anton, why is the dirt always so soft there? Is it because it's weather on the outside?
Yeah, it's where it's kind of just how that dirt is, like that Indiana like gumbo, and then it just being kind of in the elements like that. But then when they put it in the building, like whatever moisture it has, the heat is always on at the stadium. So, like, it's pretty hot and humid on Fridays and Saturdays there. So then I think that that draws it up even higher, and then it makes it even stickier. This year's dirt was way better than last year. Like, the ruts that we had last year were unbelievable. Probably, like, Toronto 09 level, you know.
That was bad.
But this year was really, really good. And, I mean, it was still technical and it was still difficult. But I think as much concern as there was going into that race for Triple Crown, Indy race, oh, my gosh, how are they going to do this? The Dirtworks crew really honed in on their schedule because every time bikes were off the track, they were back out there in the equipment tuning it up. And then I would say even as the night went on, the track dried out and got better and firmed up. I mean, it still gets blown out because there's so many ruts and there's so many riders and so many laps. But for the work that had to be done from Friday to Saturday, it seemed like the course only got better.
Yeah,
and another thing, too, about it, about Indy, with the dirt being so soft, a lot of the times it's super cold in Indiana or around that time of year, so the dirt's frozen most of the time, and then whenever they bring it in, it unthaws as well. that's another reason why it's usually freaking super rutted.
Yeah.
Yeah. And it's been drier here lately, mm-hmm. you know, and it was even warm last week. So I'm sure that there was like a nice little last burst of sunshine for them to get it in. But then, I mean, we're fully in the Midwest right now because it was 68 on Thursday, like 50, 60s all weekend. And now it's 20 degrees right now. So, you know, we got lucky at Indy that there was no heavy rainstorm or big freeze beforehand that made this thing so technical. But it was still super, super technical. Everybody yeah. just had to say how gnarly it was and how rutted it was. And when I walked the track at the end of the night just to see the ruts that develop out there and the curves to them, so many curve ruts because guys are setting up for the next section, it's nuts.
Yeah.
I mean, the transitions were horrible looking.
Yeah. Like. Scary. Concrete showing in qualifying, I think, is when I first started hearing. So that's insane, dude. Did it seem like the track, though, from qualifying to the main maybe got, or not, maybe the second main, it was a little better? It seemed like they were able to pack mm-hmm. it in a little bit more before the races.
Yeah, dude, because those practice sessions, I rewatched Race Day yeah. Live last night. Those looked terrifying.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. I feel like they were, track crew was busy all night, right? I mean, after every main event, they were going in and fixing something, you know, they were fixing some of the sketchy moments. You know, they fixed the rhythm section after the start every single time, a few places like that. So I'm sure that's a little bit of the reason why it might have, you know, gotten all a little bit better throughout the mains, but it was sketchy. I mean, there was guys going left and right all day.
Kate.
mm-hmm. Yeah.
You know, even though too, like last week at Birmingham, it was so heavy when they went over the start straightaway because it was uncovered and it took the most rain. And so when they started doing those free practice sessions or those practice sessions, and you could see braking bumps and big, like, you know, fork lug deep ruts develop on the start straightaway. We never see that. And I was mm-hmm. like, wow, that's crazy. That was so interesting to see because that's another element that makes Supercross interesting. And then to see it again this weekend in a dome stadium across the start straightaway when they would make that right out of the whoops and just the one slot car line that everybody took yeah. out of it. Like, it was an outdoor rut indoors.
Yeah. I got to say, I'm not a huge fan of the nine whoops. I get it. It's safer. But the nine whoops before a flat corner is just not good at all. It makes it so single line, dude. Like, if you missed that rut, you kind of had to flat track it. But, dude, it was just, yeah. I don't know.
Yeah.
But like, you yeah. know, even with all that end zone, you know, table to table, you had to grease that.
Yeah.
And then it was interesting to see everybody figure out what other lines they needed to do. Even on Friday, if you watch the raw video, I did two laps of Cooper mm-hmm. and he does one lap, one line, and then he does another lap inside lines, doubling more stuff, putting together what he knew he was going to have to do at like the 6 minute mark of a race later mm-hmm. on in the weekend.
Yeah.
That table to table looked like it got chewed up really bad. The first table, the off, had a little hole in it, right? I don't know. And then on top of it, wasn't it cornering kind of a little bit?
I think they were like almost cornering that whole section. They're still rounding around, right?
Yeah.
Which is
yeah.
insane, but.
And then you're trying to make your apex to make the inside line yeah. because then that field length rhythm that was after that, you know, there were a few more options to that one. So if you needed to roll or needed to double in or whatever, you had more there. But it was pretty important, especially early in the race, when you could, to make that table to table as best you could every lap. Like Kate told me in the elevator earlier in the night, he's like, oh, yeah, that's the most important section of the track is the table to table.
Mm-hmm.
Or the whoops.
Mm. Yeah. What do you guys think? Is it over?
It's getting there. It's over for more people. Like it's definitely yeah. like over for more guys, but yeah, he's good.
Dude.
He's really good.
Yeah.
But well, Kim was so good too.
Yeah. Yeah. I think I said something to him, or not to him, obviously, but like to someone this weekend. I'm like, if Jet wins all three of these mains with the track being as tough as it is, him not making any mistakes, him against the people that are in this field in the top five, like, where do we go from here? Because it's yeah. like, this was the biggest obstacle I feel like he's faced, right? You know, with the track being the way it was, other than the mud. But it's like, dude, he's so good. I mean, he started mm-hmm. up front all three times. He put himself in position. He made passes. He got into the lead, and he just did what he had to do. Even yeah. with the track being sketchy, it's like, the guy his bike skills, his everything. Like, he's just so well-rounded. And it's so crazy to me that he's so young, because it's like, some people go their whole careers and they don't figure it out.
Mm-hmm.
And then he's so young, any mistake that he makes, he learns from it, and it's almost like it never happens again.
Yeah, he's such a sponge. It's ridiculous. Like,
it's really cool to watch, and, you know, like, I just don't know where it goes from here. He's going to be winning for a long time, I feel like.
Yeah, you know? I think it's cool to watch, but, dude, for me personally, it's kind of depressing. And I think most of it's because after A1, I was like, here we go, dude. This is it. And then we kind of got teased because it got interesting after that, right? And then, dude, now it's just like those were almost flukes in a way. And I feel like it's kind of an reoccurring statement that we keep saying, this weekend's big, but we got a mutter this weekend, it looks like. So I think Seattle is going to be a big one. Like, if he can put it together in the mud too this weekend, like, dude, it's getting harder and harder to see a different outcome at this point.
He, you know, when you watch the race on television, I'll just always like make a note of where he is.
Mm-hmm.
And then the start goes, and I'm like, every single time, great start, first, second, third. And the guy is just so smooth, so precise, so controlled, like not hanging it out. It doesn't look like he's like riding 110% and a mistake could happen. And then all three of the mains, did he make a mistake? I think maybe like
he made a couple, I think.
But like not like, oh shit, but like little
ones. Yeah, I think everyone was making little mistakes, but Kenny definitely got close a couple times. Mm-hmm. But dude, then you see some of the clips like from Supercross Live or like Tommy Tenders or whatever, and dude, him doubling into the whoops and like the just the lines he was taking through that section alone was just so insane that he can do that lap after lap and not have a get off or go off the track or anything.
Yeah.
It's like when I watched on press day on Friday, you know, and you replay the video, especially of Ken, you see just how springy he is. Mm-hmm. And that's his style. Like, and that worked great for Ken this weekend because he was like a bunny rabbit hopping through stuff. I mean, that's exactly what you need to do with it being that way. And then Eli's getting more and more, it seems, into the flow of like flicking the 450 around like it's a mountain bike. Like, I saw a lot of cross ups and a lot more stuff that he was doing. But then again, like, it's what we've said so many times, Jet just does it. Like, it's just planted to the ground. Just there's always something driving forward. There's nothing that's happening where it's like wasted effort or wasted energy.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
What's crazy is to think is that like if Jet wasn't here, Kenny would have dominated that race, right? Like, at this point in his career, Ken is killing it.
Mm-hmm.
And he got three great starts as well. It's got to be frustrating for Oxen right now.
Yeah, was he frustrated after the race? It seemed like it a little bit on the camp, on TV interviews.
I think maybe in the initial part of it, but then I guess after the press conference and then through the rest of the night, and he told Wygant, because I heard Jason say this in the scrum, like, yeah, he was good with it because he gave it his all. And that was definitely Kenny giving his all, because those three motos that they went head to head, that was like the full rematch from the Chicago SMX race. Like, not to say any drama or tension or whatever, but just to see those guys go straight up. You know, Ken wants to beat Jet more than anybody right now. And Jet knows that as far as raw speed, early intensity, and in a triple crown at that track, like, Ken is the guy to beat. So for them to go head to head like that, and then Chase become the wild card factor late in that third one to make mm-hmm. it even more interesting. Yeah, I mean, it was good, but it was definitely like what you said, Chase. That was him checking another box of, oh, I can do it at this one. Like, you didn't think I could do a triple crown. You didn't think I could do this. These guys are really good here. I just took care of it right now. Here you go.
Yeah. And then I thought it was a really, really good night for Sexton. Like, his pace, especially in that last one, was ridiculous. I had to think he kind of struggled with the starts, but dude, he was flying.
You know, I want to talk to Chase in the next few weeks, and like, I don't think that you'll get a lot of answers on this subject right now.
Yeah.
But for him, it's got to be interesting as the guy to go to this team and know, like, hey, they're going to do all of these things to help me figure out this bike. We're going to go through all this stuff. This is how I'm going to take this process on. You know, everything you thought you did at Honda and everything that you had done together with those people, learning that, this challenge on top of a title defense, on top of a small injury, I mean, he'll look back on this and grow a lot. I know that so many people are already like, oh, whatever, writing him off. But just getting on the podium and, like you said, that third moto where he got his way back into it, that was as much of a stepping stone as anything else has been this year for him.
Mm-hmm. What did Chase's forks look like this week?
Still the covers. That, and it sounds like more people are going to...
Yeah.
And it sounds like more use of it is going to get to happen out there. Barsha and Malcolm, I think, are right in California. I know Barsha is there.
Yeah.
But it sounds like some of that stuff's going to spread out a little bit more. So, you know, I mean, as we've said so many times, it's super interesting. And the people that are making the decision know that they need to try it. Yeah. You know, so you can't fault them for it at all.
I noticed that Chase's clamps were orange this weekend again. So I don't know if they just didn't have time to anodize them before because they were silver for a couple rounds, or if it's a different clamp again. But yeah, I wonder
I'll
if
have to look.
Testing with clamps still too.
But like this, what I'm saying though, like I would love to talk to Chase about this stuff. All of those options that you're getting, how much you have to learn, how much feedback you're really able to give or put in. You already knew getting on a new motorcycle, you were going to have a new challenge, but this has got to be completely different maybe than what he expected, or more encompassing, because who would have thought that this kind of switch would even be on the table in November?
Yeah.
Kind of unbelievable. I mean, can't talk about it on air, but got a little insight into it, and it's mind-blowing what they're using right now and what's going on. Let's talk about Cooper Webb a little bit. He got victim of circumstance in that first moto, but he's how many points down now? It's like 16.
He's like just hanging on 21. It's not, it's just enough to stay within like a race's worth of points. You know, I think Chase is at like 23 too, so it's not too bad. Eli's over it now, but I mean, he, you know, we'll get to that. But yeah, I think as long as they keep him within a race's worth of points, they still feel like they got a fighting shot. Anything more than that though, and it's over.
So Eli, he had some interesting words for you at press day. You want to elaborate on that a little bit, Anton? Like the part about thinking he'd have a win by now.
Yeah, the thinking he'd have a win by now. I mean, that's exactly what we had asked Coker a week before in Birmingham, and then we talked about it on our show last week. And then when I saw that he was going to be on media day, I was excited to get to talk to Eli, because they do quite a few media days. He's been better about them, and we've seen in the last few years, like depending on his mood is how, or depending on how the season's going is how the mood will be at those. And so he seemed a little like guarded at first, and then I was, you know, pretty glad that he opened up and said that he expected to have a win by now, because I think we all did, and he knows the situation that he's in. But like I said last week, I think if they kept going, he would get a win eventually. I think that just by odds, he's done it so many times. But then the starts were just not what he needed this weekend, and that made it bad. Because watching his riding on Friday during media day and then during qualifying, he was feisty. He was definitely trying to go for it. And I think that there maybe had been a little bit of doubt, maybe not doubt, but concern about like, hey, Indy last year, I had a stiff neck, couldn't really ride the bike the way I needed to. Track was super rutted and technical. Already in Detroit this year, we had our problem. Have we gotten around that? How are we going to be going through this weekend? And he was proving to himself, it seems like, riding so aggressively during Friday and early on Saturday, for the starts to just not materialize the way that they did was unfortunate, because he was battling with all the guys. Like the first moto battle he was having with Jason was great. He latched on to Chase there for a while and tried to keep hold of it, but just like Chase was going forward in his own motos. So yeah, it was just a quiet weekend for Eli. And, I wonder how much longer we're going to see him out there. I hope for longer, dude. I kind of don't think that the end is as near as other people do. I don't think that he wants to have it end this way.
I don't see, from
what I've been hearing, I don't see him quitting anytime soon. I don't see him hanging up the boots. I see him keep racing.
And then, like, I think he's seen enough from other guys that have retired just ahead of him right now. Like, think of RV, Dungy, whoever. What do you do, dude? Like, what are you going to go do? Do you really just want to set in Cortez forever? Or are you going to figure out that you have an itch that you need to scratch? Or if you can keep racing and be competitive and kill it, keep doing it.
Yeah. I mean, it looks like we're going to see someone who retired, you know, a couple of years ago racing outdoors this season too. So, I mean, that's definitely something that's a real thing. Like, you know, like, what are you going to do after you've made millions of dollars, you've raced, you know, your entire life? And then, you know, you don't race anymore. Then what else is there to do? You know, just sit there and watch TV. I don't know. Yeah.
You get a job and you sell
like a ranch out.
You get a job and you sell O'Neill gear.
But I mean, I guess he's got like a ranch and everything there in Cortez.
Dude, he's got 10 like kids.
Ten.
Yeah.
Well, what does he have? Three now?
Three.
I mean, dude, he dad life, dude. Raise your kids. Have fun.
Bro. Okay, Don, like, you and I can talk about this, like having kids and all that stuff. Imagine having three kids and trying to like do this. Like, just we know other guys have kids and all that, but three kids all under the age of six or whatever, and then like, yo, I gotta take off and go do this. Like, the amount of moving pieces that are happening for all of those guys are crazy. Like, even when I got back to the hotel room the other night and I rewatched the highlights, and I was just sitting there thinking, I was like, wow, man, how complex this has got to be for Kenny to want to beat Jet and all the stuff that's happening. Like, all of those little layers that make it even more interesting of what happens on a Saturday night is nuts.
Mm-hmm. So my opinion of the Eli thing is that he's won for so long, right? If he goes this season, like, what are the chances he doesn't get a win this year? I mean,
they're looking a little more likely.
Yeah. So if he doesn't get a win this year, to go a season without a win after the career he's had, why would you want to keep going if you're not one of the guys that could win at every race?
Yeah, but I think it that works both ways. I think it's, why would you want to hang up if you can't? If you're not going out on a bang, why would you want to hang it up if he still believes in himself, you know?
Yeah. I don't know.
And especially after all this work to get to this point.
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah. I just wonder, you know, like, it's the same bike, same platform as last year. He won on a lot last year, and then he's searching for things this year with it.
Yeah, I don't get that part at all.
I don't understand that part. So it's like, he says his Achilles is not a factor.
I don't believe it, though. Because, dude, the bike looks so busy. Like, I don't see why you would want to make changes unless you're trying to maybe stiffen up the bike or protect something you're worried about hurting. I don't get why you would go away from what you were so successful on last year.
Exactly.
It's so confusing.
I would think that, but there's, again, not really any testing that needs to happen because he had a winning combination last year.
Yeah.
But with, like I said, go ahead, Eric.
Well, no, like I was just saying, you know, what I was just going to add to what Chase was saying about the bike being busy. Like, I mean, this is, I guess, like a new topic, but at the same time, I feel like it's an old topic because his bike has looked this way to me for the last ever since he was with Gilly on Hondas.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I mean, he's always ran a softer fork and a stiff shock because he sits on the back of the bike. He sits like sort of at the end of the seat. Anytime like you're watching him like go through a corner or anything, he's not completely forward all the way in the front. He's sort of either sitting in the middle, closer to the back. You know, he likes his rear high and his front, you know, low. But like I had Brock Tickle, he tests, you know, for Kawasaki, you know, and whenever Eli was on the team, like, I mean, Brock rode his bike and the way it looks, you know, I feel like, or Brock told me, he's like, yeah, it may look busy and it may look like it's soft, but I can promise you that it doesn't feel that way.
Hmm.
So like,
cricket,
I guess, setting that Eli and Gilly have come up with. Yes, it doesn't look like the standard like super stiff supercross fork or setting, but it's something that works for Eli and his riding style. I think that's something that they've perfected over the years, Gilly and himself. And yeah, it looks different. It's just not I guess the standard like stiff fork, stiff rear, low rear, you know, like bike. But yeah.
Yeah,
I could see that because in the raw video again, I see him like initiate the corner that they were going into around the whoops to do that 2-3 or 2 whatever they were doing into that first rhythm, and like it seems like it notched a little bit, but not a big deal. And then he hits the standard issue triple, and then you could see the fork go all the way through. And to what we've said so many times, Eli rides with so much more force than other people, you know, for him to get the fork to go through that, who knows how hard that really was going, you know? So if they did go stiffer, what else would they lose? But again, watching him ride on Friday and through parts of Saturday, bro, he was throwing that around. Like, he looked like the general on a mountain bike out there, just flicking it everywhere. And I thought it was rad. I was like, oh dude, he's good. He's good. We're good today. Mm-hmm. Just the starts didn't happen. And I think that like, there's photos of him going into the first turn, getting pinched into the same tough block that Hayden crashed on. And if that's happening, you know, especially in this scenario right now. You can't cross the first turn in 11th this year and think that you're going to charge away to second.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, that's fair.
No.
But, like, one more thing, and we know, like, we have this, like, whatever history, and Eli can shut down and open back up, you know, at a whim, because that's just his personality. But, like, to have a conversation with him one day of being like, all right, dude, like, how is this really? You know, like, know that we're not trying to pick you apart or anything like that, because it's got to be so weird, but just, like, this has got to be such an interesting thing to go through at this stage in his career and just be like, oh, it's this challenge now. It's not just walking into a title. It's, I got to fight my way back around Ken now in the point standings. Because, like, you would have to think it. I was thinking this yesterday. If he is out of the title fight, do you think about next year? Because he's the only guy that right now that you would consider being a title contender, being like, oh man, I should probably start thinking about next year if I'm going to win another title, because it's going to be hard to call those points back.
Yeah.
I don't think he's coming back. I mean, I just, you know, if we're all placing hunches, like, I don't know. Yeah. Why? Why put yourself through all that? Jet's only going to be faster next year. Harder to beat.
Yeah, I don't know. It just goes back to the, you know, like, I mean, I think he's a racer. I think that he knows where he's at. And I think that, you know, I mean, realistically, he had a gnarly injury last year that's it's hard to come back from, you know, and I think he just needs a little bit more time. And I think we see him next year, and I think he does better next year than he does this year.
Hey, Don, did John?
I was just gonna ask Don. It's like, do you think that he should quit? Because, you know, going back to like that Chad Reed thing, you think it's gonna hurt his legacy in some type of way if he keeps racing and not winning?
No, I just think he's accomplished a lot, and he's got to be happy with his career. I don't think he's like, I don't see Eli as being the greedy guy. You know, it's like, oh, dude, I could race again and, you know, make this much money even if I don't win. He's got enough money. He's got a great life. He's got a great family. I think, you know, the risk of being injured versus the reward of, you know, making some money, I don't know. I just think,
I mean, for him, I feel like it's not for the money though. Like for him, it's, they're not thinking about injuries. I mean, obviously they're thinking about injuries, but they're not thinking like, hey, like, you know, whatever. I mean, these guys, you know, they're racing because they love to do it. I think, you know, I mean, there might be a couple out there who are racing for the money or just doing this as a job. But I mean, if Eli likes to race and he's a racer, fuck, let him race.
I'll say this. As I left the stadium on Saturday night and I rethought about that interview with Eli, just seeing, you know, it again on Instagram, I was like, fuck, it feels kind of disrespectful asking second highest on all-time win list, like, when you going to win again? And I don't mean it in a disrespectful way, because, like, clearly he's proven he's known how to do it so many times. And, and as we've said it, you got to put the pieces together, and he knows how to put the pieces together. He completely understands that stuff, and all the people around him do too, but, like, seems like the pieces are a little different now with the people that are involved in the racing, you know, just the guys that are on the track.
Whew. You know, through my career as a motocross journalist, I've seen, you know, many reigns of terror, right? You had McGrath and Supercross. And then James and, you know, motocross, and Ricky and motocross and Supercross. And it's like, it's funny because there's always a point when it gets like, oh, when you see someone get out front, they're going to win again. But I don't know. It's always like that. There's always one guy that comes along and is like this. But, dude, Jetson is just, he's different, I think, you know. James was awesome and he was super dominant. But you're always like, oh. Is he going to just fucking yard sale and going to see boots and helmets flying everywhere? I don't know. When Jet gets out front, it just feels different to me, at least. It's just like, oh, here we go. Who's TV going to show for second? I don't know. It's exciting, but it's also kind of daunting, like thinking that we're going to have another era here and he's going to be here for a long time. It's like he came here to win. And I was thinking for myself, well, maybe he'll like say, okay, I've won everything here. I'm going to go win world championships. But no, he's already stated that he wants McGrath's record, right? So it was just a lofty goal in itself. But still, what has he got, five now? Five in his first season? Mm-hmm. I mean, I don't know. I'm not saying he's going to get it, but I'm just saying I don't see him going anywhere for a very long time.
I agree with you on the whole, like, once he gets into the lead, because I've had a lot of people, like, people in the industry, friends, all that stuff, that are like, yeah, he gets up front, and I can already just feel it kind of, here we go.
Mm-hmm.
And then you, but the funny thing about that is it makes you want to have other guys win more now. Like, I can think of a time when Eli was winning just a few years ago where we were just like, oh, fuck, he's going to win again, and he ain't going to want to give an interview and all this stuff. And now we're just like, God, Eli, just do it. Please do it one more time. And then the same thing with Ken. Ken didn't win for a while. Now we really, really want to see him win. And like, dude, RV, I remember when RV would get a good start and just start like clicking off a few good laps and put enough of a gap on people. And it was the same deal, you know? So we're just at that stage right now, which we knew we were coming to. Like, we've been talking mm-hmm. about this for months, that we knew, even after the Paris Supercross, we were all having like, how's this going to go by yeah. round 10 conversation?
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Because it's all yeah. like playing out how we, all the stuff we thought and knew we needed to watch play out is playing out like we thought it would.
Yep.
So during the race, I texted Alex. I was like, man, is Eli done? And he's like, no, he just got bad starts. You know, but like,
no.
It's really sad. Like, to see guys that were potential winners had, you know, tons of speed, like Barsha. You know, he's obviously struggling with the bike, but it's like, Barsha done? Is Eli done? You know, there's guys who are used to seeing on the podium and doing better, and they're kind of just riding yeah. it out now.
I think it's just,
yeah,
it's just so close, dude. Like, even you take a track like this past weekend, that's guys are often having a mistake or choosing a line that they didn't want to hit every single lap, right? And the lap times were so damn close. We had a tie in the 2VD class, like, for first and second. Yeah. That's ridiculous.
And,
yeah.
And, dude, and think about the craziness of that. Two different sessions when the track is completely different and they hit it on the mark.
It's ridiculous.
The odds of that are nuts. Almost to the yeah. point where I saw it and I was just like, all right, are the transponders funky yeah. or not? Because that is wild that they hit it on the nose. Two different riding styles, too.
Yeah, and that's yeah. the 2VD class. That's not even the 4VD class. Like, Eli's... I think he was third fastest. His second to last lap of the final session was his fastest lap. Like, the guys are just, they're all pushing the limit so hard right now. And it's just ridiculous. Yeah. Like, it's hard to see someone start further back than sixth or seventh and get up to the front. It's just, I don't know if it can happen, honestly.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Okay. So, Don, you said something a minute ago, all of the reigns of terror that you've seen and all that stuff, and, like, lifelong fan of the sport. Same for you, Ari. Same for you, Chase. Are you guys, like, surprised that this whole newfound thought that Supercross tracks have got to be smooth? Because haven't they always been rough? Like, if they were concrete smooth, people would be bitching about that. Like, I like the rut element to it, you know, and the places that we're going, because it is a true test of it, you know? Even when we watch, like, a Super Enduro, and you see all the elements that they put on the one track. Mm-hmm. They put that there for a reason, so they get tested by everything. Like, our guys have to go through the test. Because when 3 years ago, we were all mad that all the outdoor tracks were prepped identical.
Yeah.
You know?
Mm-hmm.
I like how the tracks have been lately. I'm not racing them, but...
Yeah. I do like it, but at the same yeah. time, like, I'm
no,
a huge...
No, I completely understand because...
Go ahead, Avery.
Go ahead. Oh, no, I was just going to say that, you know, it's... It's tough because you want the track to be smooth, but like at the same time, you know, it needs to be difficult. I agree with grooming the start straight and the first rhythm section after the start straight. Everything else, leave it.
Yeah.
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 Spoken like a man that's really not out there this year.
The only thing I'll say is I'm a huge fan of the track layouts, honestly. Like, since I was a kid, I've looked at track maps. That's like the first thing I do every week, right? And so I feel like this year, especially compared to like 3-4 years ago, the tracks are getting so gnarly. We're seeing guys go just double through sections. Whereas a couple years ago, like the top two, top three would be busting out a quad and halfway through the race. Like we're just, I think the tracks are to a point where, yeah, we had Jet try and do some stupid quad last weekend, but it's just the guys aren't able to go for some of the bigger rhythms because of how technical and just rutted the tracks are getting.
Okay. I was really curious. I was really curious if that first rhythm was going to turn into a quad.
Mm-hmm.
Like, I wonder if even on like firmer dirt that could have been a quad out.
Yeah, totally. I was thinking the same thing.
Dude, if you guys want to see a rutted Indy, go back to Indy 2016. It was so bad. It's like, get on YouTube and, you know, if you ever...
Is that AP Wind's nativity class?
I believe it might have been, yeah. But, like, I think it was Roxon and Dungy
that
freaking went at it the entire main event, and it was Death Cross. I remember just racing there and just... dog paddling half the freaking track. It was so bad. Yeah, so bad.
Okay, so this weekend we have a potential mudder, right, in Seattle?
Yeah, it's not looking great.
Has there been a Supercross series that's been wetter than the one we're having this year?
Yeah, the moistest season to the,
I mean,
the books.
I, as a guy going to the race and, you know, potentially having to shoot, I know Anton fucking dreads mud races, right? All the people involved probably hate it, like, but I kind of like have enjoyed the season because it's put so much variation in the way things turn out. It's super challenging. You know, in a mud race, anything can happen. Anyone can win. Anyone can have a mechanical. Like, look at Joe Shimoda at was that Frisco? But
yeah,
I don't know. It doesn't make sense sometimes when you, like, think about having a race in the rainiest part of the country in an open-air dome, but I've changed my mind about things. I like when the race is tough and challenging and adverse, and I'm looking forward to this weekend in Seattle.
I'm just a little worried because it's like 60-70% of rain from Thursday on. So
yeah, but look at last week's. You know, that track turned out okay. Actually, I was a little disappointed that it turned out the way it did. I wanted another splash fest.
The good thing about the Seattle rain, though, looks like it's smaller increments every day. It's not like a full deluge, like 2 inches at a time.
Okay, good.
Cold weather pickup kits are going to be in full effect.
I mean, those were coming out regardless.
Yeah. Huh? Yeah. So, anyone else we need to talk about in the 450 class?
What happened to AC? I just noticed him getting lapped like every round. Did he crash?
He had a crash. He had a crash in practice, too. So, okay. Adam had a couple. I heard his practice one was like a full ragdoll. He was all good from that, yeah. But, yeah, so...
Benny Bloss, I believe he broke his collarbone, so...
Going over the start straight away, yep.
Yeah, it's a bummer for him. Yeah.
Yeah. Dude, just got to say the turnout for AP, like how many mullet, stash moto, DBK shirts there were, or like event t-shirts or whatever, like AP's people turned out. It's like 2 hours from where he grew up in Hamilton, so that made perfect sense, but those are like his people.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah.
So that was cool. Because he got the biggest cheer of everybody.
Webb's kit was so sick.
Yes.
That was the caterpillar so kit. Sick, dude.
Why do you call it the caterpillar?
It's cat yellow, dude.
Okay.
Yeah, Mo that did the design said that he was inspired by the heavy equipment that the track crew uses, so that's what it was.
That's sick.
Yeah, that was cool. Down to the boots, too.
The boots, yeah. Good, good job, guys. That's cool.
That was a very cool collab. Do you think that the yellow was the best for it? Like the color blocking and the big two, that was awesome. I think it could have worked good in any color.
I think any color would look good, but I think that yellow was sick. We don't ever really see that yellow.
Yeah.
Mm-mm.
I think that yellow would have looked good if they did a throwback Yamaha yellow, like plastic.
Mm-hmm.
Oh yeah.
Yeah,
it's pretty close.
Yeah, but that's almost too much, though, too.
Yeah.
I don't know. Just save it for Dilla. Save it for Unadilla. Bring it out. It's gonna look sick, and then yeah.
Yeah.
All right. Let's take a break to hear from our sponsors.
X Brand Goggles was launched in 2008, and over the past two decades, they've earned a reputation as one of the elite eyewear choices in our sport. The newest offering, the Lucid Goggle, features an XDO injection molded lens for exceptional optical clarity, as well as superior protection against the massive roost that modern-day four-stroke bikes throw. At Swapmoto Live, we love the Lucid goggle for its huge field of vision. Check them out at xbrand.com. That's eksbrand.com. If you're on the West Coast and you're looking for a one-stop shop, you need to visit the guys at STR Motorsports, formerly known as Shock Therapy Racing. With over 30 years of experience, your bike will be in great hands. Whether you're looking for a custom performance suspension revalve or just a basic rebuild, they've got you covered. STR also offers motor building services. Whether you need a stock engine rebuilt or a full-blown race motor, they're the place to go. Conveniently located in Wildomar, California, they're very close to Lake Elsinore and Paris Raceway. Additionally, they maintain a full stock of oils, tires, and tubes. They can get pretty much anything you need. Check them out at shocktherapysuspension.com.
Bill's Pipes has been producing championship-winning high-performance exhaust systems for all types of off-road motorcycles since 1974. Whether you're a mini racer or simply a premix burning diehard, our two-stroke pipes and silencers deliver unbeatable performance gains. Our four-stroke exhaust systems provide affordable performance gains and are available for motocross, off-road, ATV, and side-by-side applications. Best of all, every product from Bill's Pipes is produced and assembled in the USA. Check us out at billspipesusa.com.
Did you know that in addition to being some of the coolest people on motocross, the crew at WUSA are the official importers of Talon, Kite, and Edge hubs, as well as the leading resource for DID and Excel rims. Through the years, we've tested plenty of aftermarket wheels, and the wheel building crew at WUSA can't be beat. WUSA is the source for all things associated with wheels, including sprockets, spoke wrenches, tire irons, and more. Mention Swapmoto Live when ordering anything from WUSA and get a nice little discount too. Check them out at WUSA.com.
Hey guys, it's Ryan Villapoto. Now that I'm living the retired life and not bound to factory team sponsors, I'm able to choose my partners when it comes to building my bikes. I choose Backyard Designs to create my motorcycle graphics because they do a great job. Their kits look great, go on easy, and last long.
Backyard Design has the most comprehensive and user-friendly graphic website in the sport. Use the discount code SWAPMOTO at checkout for a discount at backyarddesignsusa.com.
G'day guys, this is 9-time X Games gold medalist Jared McNeil. Off the motocross bike, I spend plenty of time cross-training on my intense mountain bike. From the super fast and efficient Sniper cross country bike to the aggressive Primer and Tracer trail bikes, or even the amazing Taser e-bike. Every intense is designed and developed in the United States and built to the highest standards. A life on two wheels certainly includes pedals too. So give the crew at intensecycles.com a look.
What's up? This is Christian Craig. As a motocross racer, being in top physical shape is a must, and my favorite way to train is cycling. And whether it's road biking or mountain biking, I rely on Roy Cyclery to keep my bikes in perfect running order.
Roy Cyclery has been servicing Old Town Upland, California since 1962. Mention the Swapmoto Live podcast for additional discounts in the show.
Guts Racing, the leaders in seat technology. Go to gutsracing.com today and design your custom seat cover. We try to ship all custom seat covers within 36 business hours. We also offer free shipping to the lower 48 states. Once again, that's gutsracing.com.
Over the past 40 years, EVS Sports has established themselves as the leaders in innovation and technology when it comes to designing protection gear for today's motocross riders. Athletes like RJ Hampshire, Kyle Chisholm, Axel Hodges, and Travis Pastrana all wear EVS when they race, ride, or whatever Travis decides to do that day. Check out EVS-sports.com to gear up like the pros.
Everyone, welcome back to the Kickstart Podcast presented by Pro Taper. So this is traditionally the part of the podcast where we talk about kind of the nonsense we got into last week. And last Friday was an interesting day because we got our guy A-Ray back on a Supercross track on Vince Freese's Moto Concepts Honda. A
really freshly prepped perfection Supercross
track. The track was dialed at like Elsinore. It looked a bit like you would assume it would at this point in the year when they're away from the West Coast. But
A-Ray,
you didn't get sketchy. I never saw you almost crash or anything.
What do you mean, dude? He got taken out and almost endoed.
Oh, well, that
was cool.
Yeah. Well, I would have definitely got a lot sketchier if I had skimmed the whoops, but the whoops were demolished. So I went around the whoops a lot. Hopefully Don didn't get any like photos of me just like jumping through them because I was just doubling through them. But the rest of the track, I mean, dude, you ride one Supercross track, you've ridden them all, you know? I mean, shit, dude. Supercross is easy. It's not hard like other sports like golf.
We coming back?
Yeah. What's that?
Are we coming back?
Did Tony call you on the way home?
No, he did not. But no, I'm not. No, that's all good. I just wanted to, you know, it was good to, I guess, get off the couch and just now know that I can just still do it and still just.
Yeah, he was awesome. Once you got it, you never lose it.
I have a question though.
It's just pure talent. That's all it is.
So Ricky's always said over the years that if he's riding, he's usually riding Supercross. Do you feel like you would rather ride Supercross than go do some motos at Paula?
Yeah, I would 100% all day. I have way more fun riding Supercross than outdoors. Hmm. Dude, I'm telling you guys this. Like, I told Mark this. Like, the one thing that I miss is in the mornings, not on race day. I don't miss anything about race day riding. Anything. I miss in the mornings at 9 a.m. rolling out to the track, a freshly groomed Supercross track, like doing the warm-ups and just cruising the laps, not pushing anything, but like just hitting your marks, right? Like coming out of a corner, seat bouncing, greasing a 3-in, and flowing through a rhythm section, not clipping, just like landing everything perfect and just hitting a turn and like hitting a 3-out or hitting a fresh set of Supercross whoops. There is nothing that can replicate that feeling. Nothing. Not a damn thing in this fucking world, man. It is the best feeling ever.
That's so sick.
Some people get outdoors whenever they like drag fender or their handlebars going through a rut or something. But yeah, for me, Supercross track. I'll ride Supercross track all day.
Mm. So without giving away what the feedback is in the video, Ray, what was that bike like? What the fuck?
He's frozen. He's frozen.
We should just put even cricket just sound effects.
There he goes.
Ray and his cricket wires.
He's back.
You there, Ray?
Yeah, I don't know why, but for some reason on my laptop, the Wi-Fi is not good.
Is it that laptop that you got at swap meet? So anyway, tell me, what was the bike like without giving all the details away?
Yeah, because you're not a big fan of the Hondas, so I'm intrigued.
Well, that's one thing too. Like, it didn't feel like they have so much development in this motorcycle, right? It didn't feel like a Honda. It didn't feel like a Honda frame. It felt it had flex. It had stability. It had all of the good things. It was a light switch. The bike was, it was a smooth linear power, but not, it was such a weird feeling power because like you get on the gas and the thing just freaking goes. Right. But it's also like a rideable light switch almost. Mm-hmm. Right. Like it felt, well, Vince, he sort of said it best. He said whenever I want my motorcycle to feel like an electric bike. So if you think like Don, like your stock Varg, it's pretty much the closest feeling to an electrical bike that
really
it could be. I mean
it's crazy torque.
The power is just so crazy, like it's all there. There's no shortness of power. I was telling someone this morning, it is the fastest non-electric motorcycle that I've ever ridden.
Oh, really? Wow.
Yes. Dude, yes.
You know what tripped me out is like, I didn't know that Freezy did starts the way he does, where he's not high RPM.
He's low.
Thumb the clutch? No, he's like, bah! Like everything all at once. And then you did
he sets up.
After Tony told you to do that, you did one and it was a really good start.
What the hell?
Yeah. So yeah, no, I did several different starts, you know, like just with, you know, like talking to Vance and the way that, you know, he sets his bike up, and him and Chad from XPR, the package that they've come up with is the best, you know, for Vince, right? So I wanted to practice some starts on the bike just because Vince is one of the best starters, and I wanted to see if it was like, hey, is it his rituals? Like, is it his freaking OCD, or what is it that he's just getting good starts? Engine package, whatever. I was super curious. So, you know, we go over there. I mean, Tony's like watching my starts too, and he's giving me some pointers like, hey, with the way you start and how you do it, try third gear. I'm like, okay. So I do a third gear start. And it was a little sluggish. He's like, all right, so bring the RPMs up just a little bit more on the third gear start. I'm like, this dude's crazy. Like, what the fuck? I'm like, all right, whatever, I'll do it. And dude, it was the best start, like best feeling start I've done in probably 6 years. Like, I don't know. Like, it was a very, very good start. I mean, you've seen it, Don. I mean, mm-hmm. it was, mm-hmm. I mean, I took off and I'm like, how the fuck did that just happen? I'm in third gear. I looked down at the bike after, like, I took the bike back to the thing and I was like, what gearing is on this? Is it like a 1456 or a 1239? Like, what is it? What's on this bike?
HEP spec.
Yeah, but it was a standard. It was just 1351, you know, mm-hmm. which blew my mind. I'm like, the amount of development that Chad XPR, Tony, and because Tony's like always there. He's a guru, right? With everything, he sees one little thing and he's like, okay, well, let's adjust the bike for this or like this, or, you know, Tony can be Tony, but at the same time, Tony is a very, very smart individual whenever it comes to racing, you know? Dude. And yeah, it was super cool. It was a cool experience. And yeah, it was awesome.
Yeah. When you did that third gear start, you're all bruh. And I was like, whoa. And I looked over and Tony's all, that's a whole shot.
Yeah. Yeah. Tony's like, yeah, that was a great start. Yeah, that's badass. And I even tried something like Vince does too. Like, I mean, Vince has no RPMs. It's just idling and then just wide
open.
Yeah. Dump the clutch and go. That's pretty much how he practices starts, which is super cool. So I tried a couple like that and they didn't feel too bad.
Yeah.
And here we go.
Yeah, dude, Avery, you riding that bike, like, I'm so glad to hear that you did some starts, because like, that was going to be the most important thing, to feel how that thing goes out of the gate. And then when you unfreeze, I'd love to hear how working with Tony for a day was, because like, everybody's always wondered. I mean, I'm sure Avery's got Tony amateur stories, but to tap into the guru, like, Don, you've seen it, he's a genius.
Avery even was on the he's on the great, and he's like,
sorry, guys.
hitting his handlebar that stops, and I was laughing, and Vince goes, wrong side.
Wrong side.
No, he didn't.
It was the best.
Oh, my God.
That's so sick.
Oh, my God.
Can we get Vincent for a show? Did you ask?
Dude, he says, I don't want to come in, and it just opens me up for more people talking shit.
No.
I don't know.
All Vince right. won't. I'm very surprised that you got any kind of answers on the start thing, because I've been trying for like 6 years to get Vince to explain the start technique and he won't do it.
Yeah.
Like, will not do it. Because the thing that stands out most to me is that he's straight up and down. Like, Barsha looks like he's about to do a kiss of death on the front fender. And then Vince is straight up and down and the bike never reacts or anything like that.
Well, he does the big everything at once.
Just the push. Mm-hmm. Okay, A-Ray, I see you, but I don't know if you're there. How was it to work with Tony like that for a day? Because everybody has like their opinion of Tony, but he's a super, super smart guy, like you said. Like, he gets it. He's not there.
There he is. No. Yeah, the best story about Tony is I hear up in, you know, the shop up in Apple Valley, Tony will get on the bike in street clothes and just, brah! Mm-hmm. They call it the Tony butt dino or something. And like, rips across the desert with no gear on.
Apparently Martin's doing that now too. Like at MCS, I've heard he'll do practice starts. Just whatever he's wearing right now, just give me the bike and let me do it.
That's sick.
Nuts. Hey, so I sent you guys forwarded you an email, but there's some interesting news for us.
Big
like
news.
Anton, did you ever go to a US Open in Vegas at the MGM Grand?
Mm-hmm. I went to the last one, yeah.
Yeah, so like, the very fact that you could bet on that race was always like, whoa, cool. So I'd always just, you know, I'm pretty conservative. I bet $100. So I never won. I bet on Ricky and he crashed out. And then I don't know. I don't remember who I bet on, but it was like really exciting to go and be able to place a bet on a motocross supercross race. And I remember I was in line. It was actually the first MGM US Open, and I heard these people talking behind me like, "Oh, we've got some insight, man. This track's going to be tight. You got to bet on the arena cross champion, Buddy Antunes." And I was just like, "Oh, yeah, right." But anyway, betting on motocross. I know there's been some other things. I think Ari talked about another guy before. But betonline.ag is it's like the largest and longest running online betting platform.
As legit as it gets.
Yeah, 20 years now. I actually talked to, you know, Mike Nitell, our crazy gambling buddy, and he knew all about it.
Oh, I'm sure.
So, yeah, so starting this weekend, you can bet on the Seattle Supercross. You go to betonline.ag, you start an account. Minimum deposit is $20 to get in. I think Chase and I, we're gonna go all in on this. We're going to put $1,000 in. And we're going to compare our bets every week and see how we do. But,
dang,
yeah.
Dang, bro.
$20 in. Mike says they pay out in like 1 to 3 days when you win.
Oh, wow, that's big.
So, there's going to be odds. There's going to be odds on every race. I think they're going to go up the Thursday before. So you can have odds on the winner, the top three, the top five, and whole shots in both classes, 250 and 450. So it's going to be super interesting, I think. And
this is huge for our sport because, dude, I have a couple of wealthy friends that I think they only watch certain sports just because they're betting on it.
Mm-hmm.
So, I mean, you get guys like that, I'm sure they're going to start tuning in to Saturday night and watching the sport more and maybe fall in love with it more. So it's exciting for sure.
Yeah. I don't know. It's like,
yeah.
How could you bet against Jet though, right?
Yeah.
But then leave it. Watch, I'll bet a bunch of money on Jet, and then something will happen. Like, I'd be trust scared me, to bet on the weekend, this weekend, Seattle, right? Mm-hmm. Like with the mud race, everything going crazy.
If you go look at any other places that you can kind of bet on this right now, there was like a few more, and the odds against Jet, like, dude, you're not getting paid if you bet on Jet. If you bet on yeah. anybody else, dude, you're cashing in.
Yeah.
And then even I played around on the website before we got on the phone. Dude, you can take that money and go bet on anything. There's one that says if there's a war against aliens versus humans, who's going to win? I don't know how they're going to pay you out on that one, you know, like if all that does happen. But, hey, man, like, yeah, go throw it out there.
Yeah. Yeah, so I think that's super cool, though. Hey, Ray, are you a betting man?
No, I mean, I try not to, but I mean, shoot, you know, we'll see how it goes at Seattle. Maybe if you guys win big, maybe I'll put some money in there for sure.
Yeah. You know, if I win big enough this weekend, you won't see me here on Monday.
Yeah. Oh, yeah.
Early retirement. Anyway, let's get back to the races. Dude, Cody Schock, collarbone. He got it plated, right? And came back and raced.
Yeah, he got it plated Monday. Went straight from operating table to therapy. I almost saw him on Tuesday. I missed him by like 10 minutes. But I was going to talk to him a little bit about
same
it.
Same doctor that did yours?
No, no. Oh. Dude, that's what's so mind-blowing for me. Because I've always heard of how collarbones are like, meh. I got my follow-up on. I had my follow-up on Friday morning. And my guy's like, look, dude, like, you're probably pushing it already by not just wearing a sling. Your stuff's already like kind of moving, so
well, yours chill out. Pieces and pieces.
Yeah, I know, but it's still like this guy's telling me 6 to 7 weeks, and then Shock's going out there and getting top five. I'm like, what the frick, dude? It's ridiculous.
Yeah.
I don't know. Like Dr. Baum, you know, a great friend of mine. Like I remember at Milestone, I crashed on Saturday. I texted him. I said, "Hey, I broke my collarbone," and he played it at Monday. And when I got a surgery, he's all, "Hey, man, yeah, it's as strong as it will ever be right now.
Mm-hmm.
Like healing won't make it stronger than the bolts and the plate." And he goes, "If you could stand the pain from the incision, do whatever you want." And I was like, "Can I ride?" And so I rode Saturday and I raced Sunday. I mean, obviously at a fucking super slow vet level, and not supercross, that's pretty badass that Cody did that. But I don't think he's the first top-level racer that's gotten a collarbone plated and come back and raced.
I think he's the first one in a week, same week.
Really?
Yeah, Dungey did it 2 weeks later or something.
Yeah, Dungey missed the St. Louis Supercross during like the height of the RV domination era. I want to say RV that Ryan missed like St. Louis or something around that.
Yeah, sounds right.
And then was right back at it. But then that pretty much like clinched RV's title at that point. But it's been a while. But dude, even just to see Cody go through that and just how he was going through the day, when he does, how is your weekend? You can see the incision mark right there just sticking out. I mean, it's up to there.
Did he have staples still or pink glue?
Contender. I think it was glue.
Yeah, they don't. I think they. My guy, my surgeon told me they don't do staples anymore.
Oh, really?
Yeah, just glue and like self-dissolving stitches, which I decided to rip out Saturday during the main event.
You did?
Yeah. Was I ruined bleeding? A Dirt Studio shirt.
Oh, was it bleeding on
Oh,
it?
Yeah. Oh, yeah. But yeah, oh. Crazy, dude. Crazy.
So that was pretty cool.
He did
cool,
therapy
though.
3 hours after it was over. Yeah. He was at Navarro's.
Dude, the loopy gas probably wasn't even. He's still probably a little.
He said the nerve block was still on. Yeah.
That probably helped.
Oh, wow.
Yeah, when he crashed, yeah. I was like, oh, no. But then they're, oh, it's the other shoulder. He fell on his other shoulder.
Yeah.
McAdoo. Super stoked for that guy to win. I was like, dude, what are with the YouTube comments, man? Like, oh, man, that guy talks about his wife too much. Or, did you see all that?
No.
Yeah, and how was your weekend? Yeah.
I saw some Instagram posts after the interviews on Saturday about that, though.
But I don't know. Super cool that he won, though, I thought.
Yeah, that was sick, dude.
Dude, Matt,
red plate.
Maddie seems down. I mean, I talk about Megan a lot. I would talk about my wife a lot if it was like Maddie. So
yeah, I think I would talk about her hourly probably. So
they're like, yeah. Dude, they're cool at the races just to see them go through everything. Like you can tell that she is his number one fan for totally. Sure. It's not like any kind yeah, of like, oh, I'm just here for this. Like ride or die for him for sure.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. She's there every week or every day during the week too.
Cool dude.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
That's how. But Sam yeah,
good
was.
For Cameron. I mean, that's the 250 East region for sure, right there.
Dude, it's so exciting. 250 class is unreal both coasts right now. It's funny because I was thinking about it on Saturday, like after the race. Not that I'm not a hater towards anyone. I should clarify that before saying this, but everyone that's in title, like has hopes of getting this championship in both classes. I would be stoked to see. Like, there's no one. It's hard to even pick as like a journalist. Like, oh. I hope they get it because everyone in the running is like kind of deserves it in a way, right? It's pretty sick.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah. Yeah. Super cool.
Anton, how was the crowd reception for Hayden this weekend?
Like, it was fine. Like, yeah. Even I heard on Friday that there was some concern of like, we don't know how this is going to go. Like, he might get booed. This could get this. And I was like, yeah, have you looked around at these people? These are Hayden's people. Like, he's just fine. And he came out, and they lost their minds. So mm-hmm. Hayden's fine. Did you see the video of the Yamaha truck, the autograph signing?
No.
Yeah.
You saw that one. They send Romano out first, and Nick's, like, pumped. And then Hayden comes out, and it's just, like, fucking the fifth Beetle just showed up.
Really?
Yeah.
Jeez,
dude. Yeah.
God.
Yeah.
Props to him, though. Full turnaround this week. I mean,
yeah,
I said on my O'Neill Racing Inside SML that he needed a quiet week of just racing. And, dude, that's exactly what he did. He... Mm-hmm. He was fast as F and got great results and maybe a little more timid than he had wanted on the interviews on the podium, but I think that's what he needed. I think it was a good reset for him.
Yeah.
Bro, how many variations of the militia twist has he done this year? It's sick. I love it. Like, they need to lean into that.
Yeah.
Like, when he went with first one and how good that battle was and then just to see the guys kind of drop away the way they did. I was like, all right, dude, Hayden's probably going to win this one. And then that third, and then he wins the second one going away. And I'm like, oh yeah, he's definitely got this one. The crash in the third one, I knew definitely was going to change it up. And there was a moment that he was out of the top five, but with two passes and he was back to third.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Ridiculous.
And then just kept climbing. And like, again, I said it in the press conference when I talked to the top three guys, you see the single digit numbers that the top three put together. And then it's a double digit gap back to fourth back. You know, the consistency that those three put together through the night was huge. Mm-hmm. But for Hayden, that was a massive come through the pack, dude, right? Ride that he needed to put on.
Mm-hmm.
So he clipped the hay bale or the tough block with his fork lug or his foot peg?
I think his foot peg.
No, I think the foot peg because he said that the rear end was coming up as he was on braking. Because he said he picked that gate. He didn't want to have to sweep wide again after last week. He just wanted the most direct shot in. And yeah, he did, dude, he did good. Because this was, like we had all said last week, was going to be a big how do you do it week, and he's definitely in title contention. And then Cameron's leading the points now, and Vial did good even after his crash to stay in it. Like,
yeah.
Is Hammaker okay?
Dude.
That was an ugly crash.
I didn't see that one.
He's had a rough couple weeks. I mean, he's pretty banged up right now just from the last couple weeks. But he's been riding throughout the week. Dude, so Seth, I'm working on some stuff with Fox with him right now. And so I haven't spent much with him, like much time with him. That kid's badass. Like his personality.
Dude, he's gnarly.
Dude, Tuesday he went, did all of his motos at the track, went from there to Irvine to do some sizing stuff with Fox, then to the gym, then he met his mechanic, Jacob, back at the Supercross track and stayed and did starts till 7 p.m.
No way.
Yeah. And then the next day, him and I were filming at the track. He was there at 8 in the morning and doing motos again. Like, ridiculous. And you know he's a little banged up right now because just, like, certain stuff in the gym he was, like, having a hard time doing. But that kid's been he's just doing motos like nothing and starts like crazy. It's pretty cool. Yeah.
What happened to Anstey this weekend?
Oof.
Just bad starts?
He went, first moto, he went over the backside of one berm, and that was pretty much it.
Dude. Yeah.
Like, didn't get hurt or anything like that, but it wasn't a good weekend.
It was a bummer not to see him up front and on TV.
Especially after qualifying, too.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, he went over the backside, like, he tried to save it. It was the Dunlop berm before the big triple. And he rode over to the top of it and then was, like, trying to fix it. And then he lost his balance and then just went down the backside of it. And that was it. But, yeah, that was pretty much the weekend encapsulated there. But, yeah, dude, like, okay, for Pierce Brown, look at, you know, Pierce clings on to get another top five finish, a fourth. And then, like, the results that he did. I mean, yeah, one tough moto, but then he was good through the other ones, too. So you're definitely seeing the 250 East region play out the way that it needs to.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Anything else on racing?
Chance Hymus's kit was sick as frick.
Dude, yeah, you like that?
Shake and bake, that's sick.
I like the helmet.
Yeah, the helmet was cool.
Yeah, helmet was dope.
Yeah. Levi Kilbarger, shout out Race Tech. Levi owns his own Race Tech service center, and then he's making the mains.
That's
the
sick. Class,
so that's a big deal. And then it's cool to see Jeremy Hand. You know, he's been making 450 main events, and Ray, he's an O'Neill guy. Mm-hmm. He's been making them in the 450 class, and then I saw him and his dad when I was getting my super parking pass on Friday, and they're like, oh, yeah, we're going 250 class. And I was like, well, that's kind of like ballsy decision if you've been making it in the 450 because he could have made it again. But the rationale that they gave was making sense. He was going to be in an earlier practice session when the track was fast, so he was going to put in a top 22 lap time, and then he could be a top 22 guy all night if he's making 450 mains. So that was good for that guy.
Hmm.
Yeah, cool deal. I think he qualified like seventh. Luke Neese, also another O'Neill guy. He's been hurt the last couple weeks. But yeah, I mean, he made the main, I believe, as well, didn't he?
Yeah, I think he had some technical problems or something.
Yeah,
there was a lot of O'Neill in that C group. I think I saw a lot of like the red kit, like four or five guys. It looked like maybe B group.
But yeah, it might have been B group. We have the Dirt Bike Depot team.
Yeah, it seems like you guys got a lot of East Coast boys.
Yep. No, that's good.
Speaking of O'Neill, I was at Glen Helen Tuesday. Yeah, I took the 300 SX two stroke out to get some laps in because we're doing the two stroke. Is it the World Championship or National Championship?
World, dude.
World Championship. Glen Helen. Yeah. World. You know what it is.
Yeah. Saturday on Easter weekend. But I took that out there and dude, the suspension works really well on that bike. It's the Race Tech spring conversion, but the reason I said thinking of O'Neill is I'm in there in the pits checking the air pressure, and I look up, and there's a guy in a van taking a picture of me. And I'm like, who is that? It was Jim O'Neill. And he's like, hey, I've got the right gear on, man. And he's like, come over here, stand here. I got to take a picture for the guy. So I'm like wondering, did he send it over to you and Mark and Frank or something?
He hasn't yet. He hasn't yet, but I'm sure if he comes in today, he'll show me.
Yeah. But yeah, he was like, so I had the 300, but I also had the Stark in the van, and he's all, man, I've never ridden an electric bike. And so I was like going to let him ride it. And so towards the end of the day, I actually took it and I rode up to, he parks up on MXA Hill. And
he told me this story last week, actually. Oh yeah, he was all pissed off last week because he freaking crashed twice. He's like, yeah, I loaded up my shit and went home.
Yeah, I was like, whoa, you're done. He goes, yeah, dude, I haven't crashed in 12 weeks and I fell twice in the first 5 laps. I'm over it. That's a bad sign.
Yeah.
So I was like, okay.
Yeah.
You know, it was pretty cool to see Jim O'Neill at the track, you know, like the founder of O'Neill, and I don't know. I saw him at Milestone one time. We both had the same kit on, and he's like, oh, let's take a selfie. it's pretty cool. Yeah. But, Ari, are you still in for the two-stroke race on the Yamaha then?
Yeah, I'm in. Okay. How's it coming?
Should I take it to race day and get the suspension done for you? Because it's stock right now.
Yeah. Are you gonna give him the cylinder and head too?
Yeah. You want to do that?
This guy.
Yeah. You're going to take it that seriously?
Yeah.
Okay. I'm going to call Checkers up. I'll see if I can get it there tomorrow.
All right. Call him up. Just drop the whole bike off there.
Yeah. You're better off dropping the bike off than leaving the forks in your car for a couple months.
Oh, come on.
whoa. We just went over the race tech thing last week. They said don't do that. Maybe Don can, but not everybody else. Yeah.
You're supposed to take the cylinder and head.
That's right. Sorry. But sorry.
They said for us, we can do that. But
I took them my whole ass Harley.
Yeah. So, but Ari, are you going to come to this race prepared? You've got 2 weeks to train.
Bro.
You're wearing
sheer talent. Did you not just see me on a supercross track? I did like 10 laps.
All I could see were these big pants.
I mean, it's not the pants' fault. It's probably my ass.
He was wearing
all the food I've been eating and the beers I've been drinking.
Yeah, so are you going to cut back on that for the next 2 weeks? And
no.
Lacerate your liver, dude. You can't drink for 6 weeks. I'm sober.
That sounds like a terrible time. Yeah. But no, I'm good. Yeah, we'll be fine.
You'll be fine?
Yeah.
All right.
What is it, 30-minute motos or something?
No, but I mean...
I thought the pro class is like 20, 25.
Yeah, they're long in the pro class.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I don't know.
Vet pro?
I'll be all right. Yeah, so, I'll be all right.
But you're racing your 500 also? Or I heard that thing didn't run.
Yeah, Mumford was talking trash on you.
Yeah. Well, I'll get it fixed. Dude, everything's going to be fine. I'm going to drop it off this week.
Okay. Carson needs to take that fleet of two-strokes he has built up and field a team for the two-stroke world championship.
Yeah, right?
Dude, he's got so many motorcycles in his kitchen.
That's insane, dude.
His kitchen.
Yeah, they're all in his kitchen. Yeah, he's got his, like, KX85 and his freaking, his badass 150 and, like, all kinds of shit in there.
All right, got a busy day ahead of us. So we're going to wrap this edition of the Kickstart Podcast presented by Pro Taper Up. Anton stayed dry in Seattle. And
we're ready for it.
We'll talk to you guys next Monday. Since 1991, Pro Taper has led the way in premium control components and prides themselves on providing an exciting, innovative, and complete product line to fulfill the needs of professional racers and weekend riders alike. Through revolutionary ideas like the oversized 1 1/8-inch handlebar and the micro handlebar kit, the only control system purpose-built for youth riders, ProTaper continues to push the limits and transform how we experience riding our motorcycles. Visit ProTaper.com for more.